All right. So going back to our variants that we talked about, how do I talk about them? It's hard to say, like, this allele and that allele consistently. So I guess we could say allele 1 and allele 2, but how do I designate which one's allele 1, and how do I designate which one's allele 2? You guys remember what an allele is? I forgot to review that. So it's the different options that you have for a variant in the human genome. So one popular option is phasing, which we talked about last time. So you can refer to the maternal and the paternal allele, but this requires all of the effort that we talked about to phase genomes and is not necessarily the best way to do it. Another popular way is using the reference genome. So in this way, you'll look at what the reference has as its base pair at that position, and then you'll decide that that is the reference allele, and anything else is an alternate allele. So here, the reference has T, and Rob has an A and a T. So the T is the reference, and the A is the alternate. That makes sense to everyone? So you can do the same thing for structural variants, although it's a lot more complicated, but we won't get into that. Or for indels. So here, the reference genome has GTA, which means that Rob's deletion is the alternate allele here. And the insertion is the reference. All right, so another way to do it is to look outside of our species. So maybe we want to talk about what the ancestral allele is. So this is useful when you're talking about like mutations. You want to know what came first. And so one way that we do that is we look at species that share a common ancestor with us. So for example, chimpanzees is usually how this is done. So if we look at the chimpanzee reference genome and we see that they have a T at this position, then we will consider the ancestral allele the T. Does that make sense to everyone? So for example, if they don't have this GTA in their genome, then we might consider this deletion the ancestral allele. Does that make sense? Just for consistency, the colors here are from comparing it to the reference genome. So just keep that in mind in case you get confused later. So we can do maternal and paternal. We can do reference and alternate. And we can do ancestral and derived alleles. Does that make sense to everyone? Any questions so far? Okay. So the next one, all of those require you to do some additional sequencing and or have a reference genome. Many times, resources that you'll use won't care about all that stuff. And so what they do is they look at the frequency in all of the sequencing that you've done. So for example, let's say I sequenced these 5 people. 3 of them are stock photos, and 2 of them are your lovely teachers. And I found these sequences in those 5 people, so 10 copies of this chromosome. I would then look at the alleles that I have for each individual. So I'm just randomly choosing what's allele 1 and allele 2 here. And then I'm going to count how many instances of that allele I have. So allele 1, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different instances of T. So that means 6 here, and so on and so forth. Then I will calculate the allele frequency. So the allele frequency is within a given population, how often do you observe this allele? So remember, this is out of 10 copies of the chromosome, not out of 5 individuals. So because of that, 6 observations of T translates to 60% allele frequency for allele 1. Usually that'll be written as 0.6, but just so you know what it is, it's the percentage. Of all of the alleles in the population at that position. And so then we define whichever allele has the highest frequency in a given population as the major allele, and whichever has the lower frequency as the minor allele. This is the definition for different alleles that I use the most because I do a lot of GWAS type stuff. So just keep in mind, if someone says the major allele, they're usually talking about the most common in the population. They are talking about the most common in the population, and that usually is the same as the reference allele, but not necessarily. Does that make sense? Yes?
Yeah, How often are there more than two different?
That's a really good question, and I was thinking about putting a slide about it. So triallelic or multi-allelic variants are relatively rare, but they do happen. So for example, I was recently cleaning a data set, and there were three true triallelic variants in there out of millions. So that gives you an idea. That's not a like a definitive answer, but because mutations happen randomly and the population of humans is massive, the more humans we sequence, the more often we're going to see these kinds of triallelic or multi-allelic variants. One thing I didn't include in here is that sometimes there will be overlap between different variants, and so that makes it hard to notate like this. So for example, you could imagine that some people have a SNP right in the middle of this inversion, and so you might see a compound variant there. You don't have to worry about that though, because you'll probably just remove those when you're trying to do data analysis. Okay, so just to review, we can talk about maternal and paternal alleles. We can talk about reference and alternate alleles, which is referring back to the reference genome. We can talk about ancestral and derived alleles after referring back to a common ancestor's genome. And we can talk about major and minor alleles, which are based on the frequency, allele frequency in a population.